Fleeing from the Cylon tyranny, the Borgcast Galactica leads a ragtag fugitive fleet of feedbackers on a lonely quest for a shining drink known as...
Welcome to Borgcast Galactica 1.8 with Anne-Marie and Peter.
Hello, yes. Oh, we have a bit of...
Last time on Battlestar Galactica.
Yes, so I put some images of Starbuck and Apollo in the Boomer in their triad outfits, and Tumblr bloody blocked it.
Oh, it's Paul.
Oh, yes. Because they've got these stupid filters there where even the slightest little bit of man flesh and it's whoop, whoop, the red lights go off. It just amused me no end at this thing that was going out at tea time, you know?
Yeah. Or was it just he had taste and went, no, that's too hideous for anyone to bust to see?
Possibly. I was watching, there's a whole disc of extras with the DVD box set, and I was watching the interviews with the cast members about the triad outfits, and the female cast members were particularly amused by it, because usually, of course, it's lots of, you know, female flesh that's on screen. It makes a change for it to be the other way around, and they made the most of it.
I can imagine.
We'll find out a bit more about that in our second episode of the evening. But first of all, we start with The Man with Nine Lives.
Which is a cat.
Yeah, the title makes not a lot of sense to me, to be honest, in relation to the episode. I mean, I suppose he just about escapes death in this, maybe, but that's only one.
Yeah.
I can't wait till we get to that gambling deck. I got a new system that can't lose.
This man could be my father.
You're at least related within 10 generations.
Yeah!
I hope you're his father, for his sake.
Aurelian Noman?
They're on a blood trail.
Clear the floor!
So, you've got an opening log with Adama, and he's talking about how they're using the coordinates, and people are generally sort of happy and having parties and celebratory because, you know,
they're on the way.
They're on the way. And you get to see the, as he speaks, the dictaphone thing, it comes up on screen.
It's suddenly become a thing, hasn't it?
Yeah. Well, one of the things I like, though, is that I'd often sat there wondering how you spelt Yarens, and it spells it for you.
Oh, well, there we go.
Y-A-H-R-E-N-S. Yarens.
Sort of vaguely German, isn't it?
Yeah, a bit. Anyway, so then you cut to one of the ships in the fleet that's blatantly an aeroplane. Isn't it? Because it's all got seats like an aeroplane.
The inside, yes.
TV screens, isn't it? On the seat in front.
Yeah. This is the Canaris, which is a brand new model. It's not the prettiest, but it's a shuttle, so what do you expect?
Well, it's basically an aeroplane. They're advertising for pilots in a really cheesy video.
Yeah, no, Omega's doing a bit of, what's the recruiting?
Yes.
This is a recruitment video. Is that yours? We need you.
Yes. Reminds me of those terrible army recruitment videos that you used to get. Oh, wouldn't it have been about 15 odd years ago?
I don't know. It reminds me more of Starship Troopers. You know, would you like to know more?
Yes, it does. Yes. And there's some old dude, and he's...
Chameleon. Although it's spelt chameleon. I don't know why it's pronounced chameleon all the way through this. But...
Well, it's because they can't pronounce anything, because they say things like Scorpius instead of Scorpion.
Yeah, but that's a completely different spelling. This is spelt chameleon and pronounced chameleon.
Oh, no. Shamon!
Shamon!
Yeah. Anyway, old dude is sitting next to this
woman. Did you work out who it was in the end?
No, I never did.
This is the one and only Fred Astaire, everybody.
What?
Yes! Fred Astaire was in Battlestar Galactica.
Bloody hell, I never would have guessed that. Really?
Yeah, he asked to appear on the show specifically.
Wow!
His grandkids were big fans. And they were like, you want to be on our show? Yeah, sure. And it literally just asks for a walk-on role. It's like, oh no, oh no, we're going to get you for a main part.
Wow.
Yeah, and he does brilliantly in it. He's absolutely charming. He's got a really good line in facial reactions.
Yeah.
You know, when Starbucks coming up with some BS and he's like, the look on his face is always brilliant.
Wow. I never would have guessed that.
And this is the last time he dances on screen.
Aww.
Yeah, yeah. That he was reluctant to do it. It's like, just, you know, just move a little bit because he's supposed to be dancing with Cyrus Blasey or Blasey or Blasey.
Blasey or whatever.
Blasey, yes. Who's played by Anne Jeffries, who jumped at the role when she learned she'd be dancing with Fred Astaire.
Yeah, I'm not surprised. Yeah, bloody hell. So they're sitting in the plane seats, and this bloke comes along. Now, I presume it's either docking cards or money he's taking, but bloody hell did it make me laugh. It's a fuck-off massive plastic thing on a pole, okay? And you have to put, you know, like children's tills that you buy in early learning centre?
Yeah.
You have to put one of those coins in, and it's bright red,
yeah.
And then watch it go
down the little
thing.
Ramp! Yes, yes, the little RSPCA donation box type affair.
Yes! Oh man, it's just awful. And it's got a few lights on the top, but I just looked at it and thought, fuck no. If there was a prize that could be given for the worst,
daftest prop
like ever, it's this. Children's play school, if they were asked to come up with a prop for preschool children, would do better than this. It's awful. Has to go on the tumblers.
Okay, I'll try and dig out a bitch about that.
It really is terrible. So Cyrus puts her token in, and meanwhile there's this interview, and it's got Starbuck on it, and Fred Astaire, I can't call him Shamon anymore.
Shamon.
He's Fred Astaire. Fred Astaire says, oh, we don't want to hear about these pilots. We want to hear about the ordinary people who don't get the same recognition. What about you? What about your job? And it's clear that he's using it as a way to not put his token in the silly little toy. But also, Starbuck's talking about the fact that he was orphaned.
There's a backstory suddenly.
Because they ask him how old he is. He's just like, I don't know. And she's like, yeah, I know you're nervous. You might as well say your age. And he's like, no, I don't know. And he explains that he was orphaned after this particular raid. And he, along with a number of other children, were found wandering in these woods. And so then, a bit later, you can see Fred Astaire sort of pricking his ears up at this, as it were. So, anyway, he's tried to con the man with the toy for not putting his little red token in. But then he comes back again and he says, you know, you didn't put your token in. And Fred Astaire goes, no, I did. You just forgot. And he goes, oh, yeah, and walks off. And this Cyrus looks at him and she's not an idiot. I don't know whether she just loves him anyway or what. But she just gives him this look as if to say, yeah, I know where you're at. But then gets off the plane. I mean, I can't call it a shuttle. It's blatantly a plane. Gets off the plane. And then he goes, oh, no, I forgot my money. And then she offers to sub him. And she opens her bag that's full of crap.
That's the coins, apparently.
Yeah, but one of them's a piece of ribbon. And then there's something.
Reminds me of the doctor whenever he empties his pocket.
Yeah, it's like, it always fluff, comes out. Jelly babies, a yo-yo,
and
bun.
When he's paying with currency, it's like, you know, lumps of putty and stuff.
Yeah. Again, I looked at it and thought, early learning centre would sell you better than that. haven't they gone into administration or something, early learning centre?
I don't know.
And I just remember thinking, again, shit props. Still not as bad as the stupid toy that wins the award for shit prop. But they weren't much good. And so anyway, he's like, oh, you know, you must come back to my place. And she looks at him and she's there.
To let me repay you.
And she's like, yes, you must repay me.
Yeah, make a donation.
Oh, yeah.
But hey, it's, you know, it's love. What the heck?
You need to pay the pant bank. So, sort of, they go through. And again, I get the impression that she knows that he's a couple of looks. But she knows and doesn't care, kind of thing.
She doesn't care because she knows she's in for a good night with him, basically, his payment.
I think so.
And hey, you wouldn't want to sleep with Fred instead.
Well, he hasn't got a beard.
No, he hasn't. Unlike...
Well, then then you cut to this fucking weird shit dancing of
Rome. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
With this... these people in body stockings dancing with Perspex sticks?
Yeah, it's like you'd expect, if it was the modern day, you'd expect them to be CGI'd out, you know,
yeah.
Have little ping pong balls on them. But no, this is obviously long before that. And they're dancing to exactly the same music they used way back in Saga of Star World in the casino there. So that's that naff music. And I could just hear Puri's chuckles of delight. Because they're doing the weird dance around those pole things.
Yeah, it's just odd.
Oh, man, who comes up with these ideas, really?
Oh, I don't...
Apparently, in the future, you can't dance without props. It's impossible.
Well, then, but you also see some people dancing, but they put their hands on each other's hands, like they're doing, like, bad mime or something. And then sort of put hands one way and then hands another way, like a totally fucked up mime Charleston or something. It's really weird.
Oh, and then you get Jolly getting really, really excited about these women in leotards.
It's like, woo! And it's his eyes on target.
Yeah.
And you're like, what? And then Boomer tries to lead him away and says, come on, let's get some food. And then he goes, I've got all the food I need. He's like, what?
Wow.
Yeah.
Jolly has an issue, I think.
Yeah.
He's been on patrol too long.
Yeah, definitely.
Jolly needs his jollies.
So, yeah. And then the blokes with all the hair appear. The seriously hairy no-men.
The O-men.
Oh.
Oh. O-man! What are we doing here?
What are we doing here?
Yay. You remember the O-men?
No.
Jigsaw. You remember Jigsaw?
I remember Jigsaw. I don't remember the O-men.
Right, the O-men turned up whenever there was a word with a double O in it, basically. This was a children's program, by the way, from way back in the 70s. But yes, and one of them was Sylvester McCoy, a very early role for Sylvester McCoy. But this isn't the O-men, this is the No-men, with their beards of wonder.
And eyebrows of doom.
And eyebrows of doom, yes. Okay, so the three of them. The leader you said you recognised.
I did, but I couldn't bloody place him.
Okay, as many because, I mean, under that beard, what hope had you got, really? But this is Lance Legault again, previously seen as Booties. Booties Call, yes, from the Western episode with the crap metal cowboy hat.
Okay.
Yeah, but better known as Colonel Decker in the A-Team.
Yes. Colonel Decker, bloody hell.
Presumably they thought, having only used him a few stories ago, they could hide him under that beard.
Yeah.
But no, that voice is so distinctive and gravelly.
Yeah, it is a very distinctive voice.
He complained bitterly about that beard that was Brillo pad.
Oh, was it?
Material, apparently, according to him, yes.
Gosh.
Then you get the one who's in trouble, Tarver, who's the younger one.
Yeah.
He's played by Anthony DeLongis, who was a barman in Babylon 5. He was reoccurring Kazon Colour in Voyager, remember him?
No.
The one who had Seska made good use of, so to speak.
Oh.
Yeah. And he was also Blade in the NAF Masters of the Universe film.
Okay.
The other dude is Bora, but he hasn't got such an interesting CV. He was an android in THX 1138, so in other words, just in a suit.
Right.
Yes. But they're cool, and they will be back.
Yeah. Well, they appear, and like... they're obviously, like, really judgmental, gloomy bastards.
Yes.
Because people leave and, you know, they look sort of cross. And they've got these sort of glitter ball things.
Glowy balls of doom.
One of them spots Fred Astaire, and this is the younger one, and sort of picks up his glowy balls of death.
He gets them out by accident, yes. You get in trouble for that, generally.
Yeah, and but, you know, now he's got them out, he can't put them away.
No, he's got a... fling them. Ow.
Yeah.
He's got balls of steel, though, because they go straight through a pillar.
Yeah. And, yeah, so Boomer sort of nominates a pillar for him to lob them at.
Yeah,
really quite weird.
Boomer takes control of the situation. Boomer
he's
fast turning into my favourite character of Battlestar Galactica. He's just so cool. He doesn't take any shit. He's very calm.
Yeah.
He does, you know, he's not hormonally challenged like Starbuck, and he's not... let's face it, slightly boring and square like Apollo. Boomer is where he's at, as far as I'm concerned.
Apollo is sweet.
Yeah. He's a bit too squeaky clean and boring for my liking. Boomer's where it's at. He's cool.
Yeah, Boomer's cool. Yeah, so then he sort of, they talk about him, and then it's like, oh, I've got to arrest you. And it's like, you can't arrest us, that'll dishonour us, or some other sort of bollocks. So then they tell the young one off, and then they make them go into detention and sit on a bench outside the headmaster's office.
Not quite, but yes, supposedly waiting for the next shuttle.
But don't you think that's what it looks like, though? The three of them sitting in a row.
It's like at my church school, any troublesome kids gets outside the staff room for playtime.
Yeah,
that's what it looks like, isn't it?
Also, aren't their hats shit?
They are shit hats. Shit hats, shit beards, shit eyebrows. It's not a good look, no. But they're interesting characters to throw into the mix. It's like they're part of the fleet, and yet they're these isolationist, puritanical, honour-bound. They're kind of pre-Klingon Klingons, you know. They're really interesting characters.
They are. So they're sitting there, you know, in their queue, and they're sort of like, no, you've kind of say to the one who's in trouble, you know, shut up and behave.
Dishonor the code.
Yeah. And then they're there again, and they're asking them questions. Boomer's asking them questions. And the younger one sort of tries to make a fight of it again. And then MAGA, as in MAGA Hat Man, presumably, sort of stands up and says, no, you're the one who does the dishonouring, and takes the weapons off him and says, I don't know him anymore. You can take him and arrest him.
And they all turn their backs to him. Ella.
Yeah.
Klingons. But again, pre-Klingons being into honour anyway. I mean, obviously not pre-Klingons, but pre-honour being a big part of Klingons.
Oh, so they lead him away. And then you've got Starbuck saying he's got a new betting system that can't lose.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
you know how that's going to end up, don't you? He uses his high-tech calculator.
Oh, he does. That's just terrible. It looks like the one on my desk at work.
Oh gosh, you use a calculator?
Yes, because Microsoft, since it did its upgrade, doesn't give you a calculator on your computer screen.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's not
why
there.
I will never convert to Windows 10 if I can avoid it.
And you can Google calculator, but given that they're for free in the back of a cupboard in the admin department, you go to the admin department and get a free calculator rather than having to use Google. It's quicker.
Boobies. Anyway.
Yeah. I mean, it's a proper basic calculator, but it was free.
Nah.
But yeah, it's not quite as bad as the adding machine that I had at the age that I was watching Battlestar first time round. It had till receipt in it, and it printed that shitty purple ink.
Yes! Why? Why did it do that?
I don't know. But it didn't give you a display that you could read. You put the numbers in.
Oh, that's why it did that. I can't remember.
It was a bit like a small calculator typewriter thing.
Right.
And so it did the sum for you, but it wrote it out. You know, like when you was in maths lessons and you got told how to write, like in columns and shit, with lines for the total? It did that.
Right.
And it made funny whirring noises, and it came out in purple ink.
Okay.
Sorry. It had a special shield.
Yes, all right, let's move on.
Sorry. Anyway, Starbuck's convinced his system can't lose, and he seems to be doing pretty well. And Apollo's sort of next to him going, yeah, I'm still not so sure about this. You lost me loads of stuff before. And then Fred Astaire appears and goes, yeah, but if she does the thing and then the dinar and the whatevers, because I don't understand any of the terminology they're on about, it won't work. And lo and behold, to be fair, Starbuck's like, and takes some of his money back. And then it turns out that for whatever reason, Fred Astaire was right. This is the point where he says his name is Shamon. And he then says, you know, oh, I'm a geneticist and I'm looking for, I lost my son on this attack or whatever. And you're like, yeah, right, you've just been watching that on the telly and all the rest of it.
I mean, you can see how someone who was able to do that would be a real asset to the fleet, because clearly there have been children separated from their parents and the whole panic of having to leave the colonies at the last minute because of the Cylon attack. So, you know, it makes sense, but it's never quite clear whether that really is his occupation or he's just bullshitting his entire way through this episode. I don't know, because they do run tests and things, don't they? So he knows about them. And he talks about genetic testing like it's a new thing. I mean, obviously it's not new to us now, but I guess it was in the 70s.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's a bit of a curious one, that, just how much of his bullshit is actually bullshit. Because he does actually turn out to be, in the spoilers, Starbuck's dad.
Yeah.
Despite the fact that he's actually bullshitting about being Starbuck's dad. It's really weird the way this plot goes.
The only thing I can think of is sort of taking cues from Garrick, which is where...
Wow, I can hear gasp from Tumblr now. How dare you?
Sorry. Which is partly that he's beginning to... You know, is it that he's beginning to believe his own story?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because Garrick's whole thing, isn't it, is that what is truth? And the lies are even more the truth than the truth
Is this kind of like he's telling loads of lies, which then turn out to be the truth?
Yeah.
It's like, okay.
So is it that he's so used to telling stories he doesn't remember what's true anymore?
Yeah.
Which makes... I did wonder, at that point later in the episode, where he says, it can't possibly be true, I'm just going to bugger off kind of thing. It did make me wonder. But also, as well, I don't know that it was Garrick who said this. It might have been someone else, I'm not sure. Because I read a lot of spy novels, so it could have been any of them. But the idea that the best way to lie is to stick as close to the truth as you can... kind of almost up until the last moment, because then you're less likely to be caught out.
Mm-hmm.
So if that's the case, then it could be that his main job is very similar to what he says, but maybe it's like really shit pay, or he only does it as a volunteer or something, and so he spends the rest of the time going around conning people. Do you know what I mean? That it's sort of close enough, but not necessarily completely the truth.
Right.
But again, it's a guess. It's not based on anything that he actually says. So then they're going to go and get this genetic testing done to try and find out, because, you know, there were thousands. They narrow it down initially to... Is it within 10 generations? Which, if you think about it, is not very narrow at all, isn't it?
Not really, no, but anyway.
Yeah. So then you have this bizarre scene with Cassiopeia and the two guys and massive magnifying glasses and something about taking a photo of a cell in his brain?
Taking out a cell of his brain in order to... Yes, they have a very weird way of doing DNA testing. It sounds like you end up with a lobotomy if you're not careful.
Really? Quite. I'm just sitting there when she's saying that and Starbuck's panicking, and I think you're supposed to think that he's a bit of an idiot, but I'm with Starbuck.
Yeah, I know.
What?
You're taking a bit of my brain?
Yeah.
Replace it with some sand, maybe. I don't know. Sorry, it's we watched...
Baba Hotep.
Baba Hotep last night.
That's all sort of quite odd.
Mm.
And then you've got Boomer and Apollo going, yeah, how likely is this? And they're basically suspicious.
Yes.
And
Apollo uses the interesting phrase that he's an Aquinas's atrum.
A what?
Yes. Which...
Aquinas' horse. Does he mean Trojan horse?
He means a horse's arse. Atrum.
Really?
Yes.
Oh!
Yeah. We'll just skip a bit of a bizarre bit of phraseology, but there you go.
Okay. Wow. So, yeah. So, they're suspicious. They're just...
But Sheba's all like, oh, no, he must be... He's like, oh, f*** off.
Yeah,
She's being so naive in this.
Very. And then you see Ty with the new recruits. And initially he's kind of like, you know, welcome, and, you know, you might be a bit disoriented, so here's your Omega Man or whatever his name was
called. Yeah, he's Omega, yeah.
Wow, okay.
Yeah.
And he'll show you around, and then the Bowmen appear.
The Omen.
And they say, you know, that they're going to join up.
Mm.
And then you get this 12-year-old who's... in charge, who says where they go and what they do.
Oh, you mean Corporal Lomas?
Well, don't you think he looks really, really
he
young?
He does look quite young, yes. Is that the guy you're talking about?
Yes, yeah, him!
Yeah. He was previously a deckhand in Saga of a Star World and one of the guards in War of the Gods. He crops up in Deep Space Nine as Shakar's assistant, although he looks a lot older by then. But here, yes, you're right, he does look about 12, bless him.
Yeah.
And, yeah, he gets bungled into a cupboard, basically.
He does! He's just like, no, you can't go there, you can't go there. Oh, all right, then you can have that room. And, yeah, and gets clobbered. But this is the sort of thing that I think now we're more sensitive to, but we weren't back then. They basically say they need a prayer room, don't they?
Yes, I know, and he's like... oh gosh, that feels kind of, you know, now, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. How dare you have a go at our religious rites? Yeah. And it's like, oh, I suppose, yes, we'll have to find you somewhere then. It's like, wow, that's progressive for the 70s.
Yeah.
I'm impressed.
Yeah.
So they need a multi-faith prayer room.
Yeah, they say they just need somewhere private, is what they say, which sounds completely
reasonable. And
yeah, it does, but yeah, they then clobber him in a cupboard.
Setting the you know, the path of ecumenism back.
Yeah. So then you have Ty appearing and saying to Boomer and Apollo, oh, you know, I've done that security check you asked.
Right in front of Starbucks. You then... plonker tie. Really?
Oh. And then Starbucks all sort of like, oh, I disown you as
really
my friend.
Really badly. And, oh, it's bad. It's like, oh, really? Any sympathy you might have had for him? Gone.
Yeah.
Oh, my, but he does it again in the next episode as well. It's like, really, Starbucks? Really?
And then you have Starbucks and his dad... And his dad's in a shuttle.
He talks about streaking through the stars. Ooh, that's going to be cold.
Oh. Do you think he'll lose his keys?
Oh, don't. Oh, no, I've got to explain this. Thank you. So, yes, one New Year's Eve in my youth, I thought it was a jolly good idea to streak across a football pitch, as you do. Which would have been a jolly funny laugh, except I was holding my jeans in my arm as I streaked across, and at some point across the football pitch, my keys fell out my pocket, and then me and my mate spent the next at least 40 minutes looking for my damn keys so I could get into my house. By which time we were quite sober and feeling not really good about ourselves anymore.
I'm surprised they didn't just lamp you.
Yeah, and quite rightly so as well. Anyway.
Yes. So Starbucks says he's going to resign to spend time with his dad.
Yeah, that makes no sense either. Why does he have to resign to spend time with his space dad?
I don't know.
I'm sure he gets, you know, he gets time to hang out with all the guys and Boxy and, you know, why is he worried he's not going to get time to hang out with, yeah.
Anyway, Fred Astaire's like, but what you're doing matters. You need to be defending the fleet. And then you hear... Sorry, this is where I'm not quite sure.
Well, the O-Men turn up.
Yes.
In the lift, but they're wearing the Reds crew...
Yeah, it's a uniform, work crew
uniforms, which, interestingly, are almost exactly the same as they are in BSG.
Yeah. Well, because they're boiler suits, aren't they?
Yeah,
they
basically, are, yes. You know. Space boiler suits, but yeah. So they turn up.
Yeah.
And then they start a fight.
Yeah. And Starbuck loses his blaster and a bit comes flying off it.
It does. It actually separates. You watch this bit.
He breaks his plastic blaster.
Yeah. So then Fred Astaire has the idea of using the lasers on the ship to fire at the
boat. Yeah, which is nice. That's cool. Yeah.
But in the meantime, it turns out that the security check that they've done on Shamon says he doesn't exist. So therefore... Boomer and Apollo are heading down to the bay to try and find Fred Astaire. And they see what's happened.
About it, yeah.
And to challenge him. And he's like, these guys are, you know, in the launch tube. And you need to see to them. They fired on him. And then it turns out that they've been looking for a Captain Dimitri.
Yes.
And he says, oh, yeah, well, that might be me.
It's his alias.
Yeah, and this is the second time I've seen this in not too long a time, and it still doesn't make any sense to me. It was all about cows.
Yes, because he was supplying them with cattle for food, basically, so they could live their own independent lives. But he diddled them on the deal, and that's why they're after him on the, what do they call it, the blood trail?
Blood oath?
Yeah.
Something like that. I think they call
Blood trail sounds like what you leave when you've had your period, sorry.
Nice,
yeah. The places my brain goes. Anyway, so, yes, they're not best pleased with him anyway. So that's the reason. It's to do with him supplying dodgy goods. He's a bit of a sort of Harry Mudd type character, basically. He's a wheelie dealer.
But it's just, it seems a bit, you know, they're going to go and kill him because of but
that's the kind of, you know, it's the code. The code is the code. Business.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. It just all sounds really...
Your glowy balls out. You've got to use them.
Yeah. Or you'll be a period stain or something.
Oh, I don't know.
But it's... I guess I was expecting something like, you know, you killed my son.
Yes, or, more dramatic.
Do you know what I mean? Than fucking you cows.
Sold some dodgy burgers.
Yes! Just, you know.
You what? Gave me the trots, you bastard.
Right,
you?
You know.
Yeah, but that's the kind of men the O-men are, you see.
Right.
You don't mess with Lance Legault.
Right, okay. But then Cassiopeia appears as Dimitri's going to fly off and says, it's 100% match, you are Starbuck's dad.
Mm.
And he's like, don't tell him. He wants to give everything up for me. That's wrong. It doesn't work. Don't tell him.
On the one hand, it's like, it's pretty appalling that he's not going to reveal that he is Starbuck's dad. Because, you know, the poor puppy has been waiting all episode to find that out. But also, on the other hand, it is kind of noble, isn't it? Because he knows that that'll mean that Starbuck is giving up his job. And he knows that they need people like him in the fleet.
Yeah.
So it's an interesting resolution. I'm not sure I'm completely happy with it, but it's certainly interesting anyway.
So then you kind of end with this thing where they're all in Adama's office. And Adama's kind of, what am I going to do with you kind of scenario. And Starbuck's like, can I see you sometimes? And he's like,
he's
yes.
Hellishly forgiving, isn't he, for this guy who pretended to be his dad?
Yeah.
It's like, I would have thought Starbuck would want to punch his lights
out,
actually.
No, he said sometimes you got to do what you got to do. I don't know. Yeah. I think maybe it's Starbuck recognising a kindred spirit.
Maybe, you could argue, but it still sounds unlikely, I would have thought. But anyway. Yeah.
I don't know. And then you've got the Cyrus who wanted the money in the pants bank has offered to bail him out.
Yeah, basically. So heaven knows what the price tag of that's going to be. But,
yeah,
you know,
and basically Adama does a face palm and then you end.
Yeah. Oh, Orko.
Yeah.
It's a funny old episode. It's what it is. It's never boring.
No.
And it's not icky like previous single episodes quite often have been. It's not a Western, thumbs up. but it is bloody odd.
Yeah.
And it's f***ing Fred Astaire.
I know. I know. Fred Astaire.
I mean, I know Doctor Who over the years got some interesting characters, you know, actors to appear in it, but it never reached the levels of Fred Astaire.
No.
I mean, that's just stunning. I mean, even John Nathan Turner in his most off-his-face, coked-off-his-tits moments would never have thought of trying to get Fred Astaire into Doctor Who.
No.
And here he is offering his services for Battlestar Galactica, which hasn't even run for a season yet. But his grandkids are fans, so.
But, yeah, I mean, wow. I mean, the thing is, he's bloody good,
isn't
he?
He's brilliant in it. Yeah, he's really
amazing.
Lovable. There's not too many people who could have pulled this role off, and he did.
He is a lovable rogue, isn't
he?
Yeah,
he is. Yeah, yeah.
And also, it makes sense that he's Starbuck's dad, because
he's... Yeah, you could see it.
Yeah.
It works. It's crazy, but it works.
And then you've
the whole business about the whole plot being about him selling beef to the
Omen. The fucking cows makes no sense. I just know. Just, wow.
Perhaps it was the secret sauce he used.
Oh,
no, let's not go into that.
Yeah. And I think what it was is that I thought that the last time we'd watched it, because I'm sitting there thinking, it was after a while, there's like bits I remembered and bits I don't. And I remembered them all lined up like naughty children. The Bowmen. I'm like, oh,
what do you keep calling them, the Bowmen, by the way, then?
What are they called? The No-Men? The
No
Bowmen.
Men. Yeah, it's No Men if you want to go down that route. But Bowmen? They don't even have bows.
No.
They have glowy balls, but they don't bows.
I think probably I've just gone B-O for bollocks and then put men at the end and made it Bowman. But anyway, them. The twats. The hairy twats. I remember them all lined up. You mean like they was outside the headmaster's office? When Fred Astaire appeared, I didn't remember it was Fred Astaire, but, you know, I remember that part of the plot. And then as I was thinking, you know, I can't remember quite how this resolves. And then as he got closer and closer and closer, I'm sitting there thinking, isn't it some fucking shit about cows? And then I'm sitting there thinking, no, I must have misremembered that. No, it was some fucking shit about cows.
Wow, well, let's find out what other people made of this.
Yes.
Interesting episode.
Yeah.
We've heard from Dory. I thought this was pretty good. A big improvement on some of the single episodes we've had. That's certainly true, yes. Apart from the weird dancing with props. Yeah. The Chameleon character was reasonable. Okay. The double twist in his con man stories were quite funny and slightly unexpected.
Yeah.
Slightly.
Yeah.
He's bullshitting and then the bullshit turns out to be right. Starbuck being as eager to fall for Chameleon's con as the girls he appears to almost prey on. But then the DNA apparently shows Chameleon is Starbuck's dad, but he swears Cassiopeia, the woman the playboy Starbuck thinks he could settle down for, to silence. Yes. Well, it's certainly surprising, isn't it, Doreen?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. And it's, what do they call it? Not pair bonding. It's something like that, though, isn't it? When they get married, they call it something else.
I don't know. Is so, pair bonding what you do with super glue?
No. That's... I don't know what that is, but anyway.
Okay, sorry.
It's from something pair bonding, isn't it? But not from this. I think they use a different phrase. But anyway, there we are. Thank you, Doreen.
Thank you. We've heard from Jeff. He writes, with the threat of the Cylons apparently over, the crew of the Galactica can relax for a couple of low-key episodes. Hollywood icon Fred Astaire is a con man posing as Starbuck's father. Stunning twist, he is Starbuck's father!
Yes.
I think that's the basic gist of The Man with Nine Lives. What I liked about the episode was the little glimpses into fleet life, where the monopolistic... Oh, I can't say that word.
What's this?
Monopolistic
broadcast.
What he said... Right, what he said, broadcast network,
yeah.
Providing everyone's information and entertainment. The recruitment ad, starring Omega of all people, was yeah. A cool little touch. Most interesting of all were the Borrelian Gnomon. They said, that's what it is. That's why I wrote Bowman. It's Bow for Borrelian.
Ah!
That's my notes. Right. It was my shorthand.
It was Bowman for Borrelian Gnomon. Okay.
And I just forgot Borrelian because they
Gnomon.
Were... Yes.
I'm Lance the Goat.
Who I'm sure most everyone noticed bore more than a strong resemblance to the portrayal of Klingons in the beginning of Next Gen. Yeah, definitely. I wonder if Roddenberry saw this and took notes. Quite possibly. Boomer was impressive again, keeping a calm head and taking charge during a crisis situation in the ultra 70s dance show. He and Apollo should ditch their wingmen and spend more time together. I'm sure it would save them plenty of headaches.
I'm sure it would, actually, yes.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Yeah, but then wouldn't you have Starbuck paired with Jolly? And wouldn't that be a recipe for disaster?
Yeah, it'd be an interesting cock-up, I would have imagined. Yes. Let's hear what Puri has to say about this one.
Hello, Orgs. Puri here to talk about the Battlestar Galactica episode, The Man Who Lived Three Times, Nine Lives, Three Lives, I can't remember. To be honest, this episode is incredibly dull and forgettable, so much so that I couldn't even remember the title, nor could I really bring myself to get up and look at the DVD box, which is sitting merely a metre or so behind me. So I saw where they were going with this, but it's a really hoary old plot of a bloke pretends to be Starbuck's dad in order to get himself out of trouble, and hijinks ensue. I mean, he's pursued by some, I don't know, Klingons, maybe, with weird glowy, throwy things that will explode in their hands if they hold on to them too long. Where have these guys been through all the big battles? I mean, they look pretty handy in a fight. So I've got to wonder why they haven't been involved in anything else. I found this really dull. It was really just those Klingon guys wandering about grumbling at each other and growling and that sort of thing and scowling under their big eyebrows. And Starbuck's dad being vaguely dodgy. And that was about it. And, you know, Apollo going, I think you're dodgy, and Starbuck saying, hey, he's probably my dad. This one really didn't hold. This one just, it plodded, it dragged. You were just hoping the whole thing would be over. We had some, they all go for their little holiday, and they did try to do something like space disco, but it was more space interpretive dance with all the glass rods and the dancing and in the weird bodysuits. And for some reason, everyone's really excited by this. They're short of entertainment, and I suppose we see that as well with the Fleet Network, IFN. Despite being on the run from killer robots and running low on resources, they've decided to start a TV station with chat shows and that sort of thing, complete with... I suppose it does make sense. They probably had the equipment. Someone might have had a camera or something, but it still looks really... it looks, like 1970s American TV. That's kind of entertaining. But overall, this episode was just... ponderous. I think they were trying to do some character work, and the script just wasn't up to it. I didn't really like the character. And then the kind of resolution at the end that, oh yeah, but those guys were kind of not really that good. They were a bit bad. They were hoarding. And he's also a bit dodgy, but not too bad. And he is Starbuck's dad, but he's not going to... I'd given up caring by that point, to be honest. I was just glad. When they were kind of rushing the end, I was just glad because the episode was finished. So, yeah, this one really wasn't that good. So, will the next one be any good? Well, we'll find out. But for the moment, I'll say bye for now.
Bye for now, Puri. Oh, I'm sorry you didn't enjoy it. It was Bobbins. We can't disagree with that. But for me, it was such wonderfully random Bobbins. It kept me entertained.
It was fun Bobbins. From my point of view, and yeah, it was space interpretive dance, to be fair.
Oh no, you see, even the dance didn't appeal to him. No. Oh no.
No, sorry.
Space disco fail for Puri.
Yeah.
I think the Omen are a bit too isolationist to be used as, you know, part of the fleet, basically. Now, raised eyebrows when they sign up, the two of them sign up originally for their own nefarious reasons.
I think they've blotted their copybook by now, haven't they, really?
Just slightly. But I believe there's more to come from them.
Really?
Yes.
Oh.
Oh, yeah. Anyways, that's for another week. Let's find out what Drew and Tracy made of this one.
This is our feedback for the man with 9 lives.
And what did we think of that one, then?
Not very good.
No. That was shit.
Yeah.
Actually, that's a bit harsh. I wouldn't go so far as to say it was shit, but there was so many, like, oh, for God's sake, moments in it. I was just like, really? Let's go through it then, shall we?
Okay.
So, instantly, you've got this pulling at the heartstrings story about Starbuck being an orphan.
Yes.
You knew instantly what was going to happen here, didn't you?
Well, that he'd turn out to be faking, was he chameleon? Well, yeah, because we could see that he was running away from the no-men, and so...
The Beryllian no-men.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we knew that he was going to try and use Starbuck, but then it kind of flipped, reversed it, and then it actually turned out that it was his dad.
That was a terrible twist at it, wasn't it? And oh no, don't tell her. It's just rubbish, really.
I just felt really kind of... It was kind of a little bit over the top. So Starbuck doesn't even know that this guy is his dad, yet he's already confessing that he's going to give up his position in the fleet and he's going to dedicate his life to basically making it up to his dad. Well, actually, Starbuck, you ain't got nothing to make up for. You're the one who was kind of left. Surely your dad would want to reciprocate if he was your real dad, and his dad was all a bit like, no, you don't have to do that, you don't have to do that, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, he would have picked up from that, actually, why does my dad not want to spend his life with me? So Starbuck and his system, when playing, I can't remember what the card game is.
Pyramids
or something
like that.
That's right, we can call it pyramids. But his system is surely cheating.
I know.
If you're using a calculator to calculate your odds when you're playing cards, he's almost counting cards, isn't he? Because, like... Yeah. Chameleon was like, you know, you've got 3-1 odds on here picking out that card, and that's cheating. That's like a bit of rainbow
going on there.
You wouldn't
get away with like taking a calculator or a computer into like a casino in reality, would you?
No, you would not. So I just have to mention these Beryllian no-men.
Yeah.
They had some Neanderthal looks going on.
Yeah, the old highbrow.
Big highbrows, and they had like some big hairy eyebrows going on.
Yeah.
But the young no-man... He was naive. He was a bit keen. He kept, like, you know...
Getting his balls out quick.
Like every young man does, to be fair. You know. And then, like, he kind of back-chatted Apollo and Boomer.
Yep.
And then they banish him.
You're off the
roster. That's just a little bit harsh,
it was a little bit
it?
Over the top, wasn't it?
You know,
like, two mistakes and you're out.
Yeah,
I thought that as well.
You know, tell him off. Mm-hmm. Give him a... punch on the chops or something, but don't take him off the list.
Yes, I know.
That's harsh. So I had to laugh.
Yep.
When the comms guy, which I now know his name is Omega, was doing like the public service announcement to try and do the recruits.
Yeah, we've seen him on the bridge, haven't we?
But surely, if you're going to recruit to like the Galactica, you want fucking Adama getting in there
Why was he not doing it?
Come and be like me. Don't be like
Mr.
Quiffy McFluffy Hair Omega. No, that wouldn't make anyone want to do it.
No.
So when the Gnomen start looking for... They karate chop the guy who's in charge of the... I want to say the dormitory because I can't think what else to call it. And also, when Omega called through to the dormitory to kind of warn him that the Gnomen were there, he didn't fucking give him a chance to answer, did he? He was like, Adam was like, call through. Did it? No, he's not answering.
No, he
didn't even ring. Come on now.
I thought that as well, yeah.
But when they're kind of fighting Starbuck, to be fair, their argument is not with Starbuck.
I know, why were they trying to kill him?
So why were they trying to kill Starbuck? But also... they then realise that he's unarmed because they can see that his gun's gone flying, yet they're still chucking their balls at him.
Yeah.
It's just not right, is it?
No.
No.
There's a lot not right with the whole episode, really. It wasn't great, this one, at all, to be honest. Back onto, like, a single episode and it's rubbish, really.
I get the kind of feeling that at some point Galactica, well, Battlestar Galactica was big and they've kind of had a draw for all these kind of old... 60s, 70s actors. Like last week they had Patrick McNee, was it?
Yes, yeah.
This week they've got...
Fred Astaire.
Why?
I don't know.
They really don't need to be in these episodes. But anyway, this was just a bit...
Yeah, not great. Leave it there though, shall we?
Yeah?
Yep.
All right, leave it there then. See you later. Bye!
Bye! Oh dear. We're going to be the minority here, aren't we?
I think so. Why are they still chucking balls in?
Well, who wouldn't at Starbuck? Anyway.
Quiffy McFluffy.
Yeah, Omega isn't the most likely recruiter ever. I'll grant you that. I mean, Athena would have been better, or possibly even Rigel. You know, hey, you join up, you can change your hair every 5 minutes. Oh, dear. Oh, dear.
Oh. Is it just us what like
well,
this?
Well, let's find out, shall we? Because we've also heard from the Llama God. What did he make of this one?
All right, then. The Man with Nine Lives. So, an interesting episode this. We've got a couple of things going on here. So, the B plot is that we have the possibility the con man in the fleet is Starbuck's dead. And the A plot is... there isn't actually much of an A-plot to this. And, this episode really does feel like a B-plot, desperately in search of an A-plot. The Starbuck Dad thing could very well have been an A-plot had it actually been strung out and it been interesting, but this episode is, as well as being a bottle episode, clearly to save money, is so very slow. I know that certain things happen, things appear on screen, but at the 15-minute mark, I looked up and went, has anything actually happened yet? It's a very slow burn, you can see where it's going, you can see what's going on, and there's an awful lot of nothing, and really, really, why is this an episode that should have a lot more emotional impact than it does? It just didn't seem to do a very lot for me, I'm afraid. I mean, you do have some interesting things going on. I think the most interesting thing for me really was the discovery that Fred Astaire is actually Starbuck's dad. It wasn't just a con that he was playing. And it's nice at the end that he tells Cassiopeia to keep it quiet from Starbuck for actually good reasons. I mean, it could well be because he just couldn't be asked to be a father either, but at least the reasons that he gives are actually quite nice. They're good character reasons. It's the best thing for Starbuck, so Starbuck doesn't jack it all in. I really like that. And there are some good character moments in this episode as well, especially Starbuck being hopeful and falling out with his friends just because they don't seem to be supportive of the fact that he could have actually found his father after all this time. And you do learn some things about Starbuck. You learn perhaps why he's the way that he is. And so this should be interesting stuff, but it's just not delivered in an interesting way. There is the action plot that drives things forward. It's not very actionful in that we have the pound shop Klingons that Fred's on the run from. Okay, admittedly Star Trek hadn't actually done the big four-heady Klingons by this point, although maybe they were doing it concurrently with the motion picture, I'm not entirely sure. And they hadn't actually done Klingons as this kind of trope before, but that came later. It still seems very derivative. The one good thing I did like was the fact that when the young, whatever, I don't know his name, when the young one draws his weapon and he has to use it or else it's going to explode, that's a nice actual change to a trope, you know, the whole a drawn sword must be used. That trope happens a lot in fantasy fiction, so that actually being a practical reason why he has to actually use his explosive device because he's drawn it, that's interesting. What isn't quite so interesting is the fact that when the Cup-Price Klingons board the Galactica to enroll in the training program, they're actually allowed to keep these things on them. It's like, why? Why would you do that? Why would you let them take explosives into the, you know, into the hangar deck, the crew quarters? It just... That just doesn't really make any sense. But yeah, a lot about this episode doesn't really make a lot of sense. But there you go. Another piece of trivia that did annoy me was discovering that Sheba is now piloting the shuttle back to the Galactica. I mean, wasn't there this whole thing right at the start of the season about how, you know, women were only allowed to be shuttle pilots because that's not as dangerous, but now they've graduated to be able to be Viper pilots? And Sheba is a trained Viper pilot. Why is she doing flying the shuttle? Unless, of course, if someone's having an off day and she's covering, but still, it felt like a bit of a demotion for her, unless it's just a way to shoehorn her into the episode. But ultimately, yeah, this was very disappointing. The only real high point of this was at the very least that Boomer and and others were able to see through the bullshit that Starbuck's dad was clearly trying to peddle for them most of the time. So at least the characters weren't all completely stupid, so that's something. And the fact that Starbuck was actually generally hopeful, it was a good performance. It was a good performance. And Starbuck's speech to his father about wanting to do something life rather than death, I mean, that was nice, well delivered and everything. And discovery that he was clearly raised by wolves outside an aggro city. He was raised outside an aggro city, yeah. That explains why Starbuck's so full of aggro. But I do wonder whether they'd have actually done something more interesting, you know, with having Starbuck's dad lurking around the fleet somewhere, whether they'd have come back to that. And so it's a shame that that was really curtailed by the fact that they actually didn't get renewed for a second season. So it would have been interesting to know what was planned for that. But oh well, can't really say anything more. Could have been more, could have been more interesting, and ultimately it wasn't, which is a shame. All right, on to the next one.
There we are. He was underwhelmed as well.
Yeah.
Oh dear.
We called them pound shop Klingons.
Yeah. So I say, as he points out, slightly unfair considering they predate the Klingons, as we, you know. As
yeah.
We know them. But yes, you can't take the Omen's balls off of them. I'm sure that's not a thing, really.
Mm.
Not fair.
No.
For religious reasons, clearly.
So we found this a lot of fun, and nobody else did.
Oh, okay. Never mind. I will be very interested to see what the reaction to the next episode is.
Yeah.
Because I think it's equally crazy nuts, but fun. But we shall find out.
Yeah.
Those two keep at it. They're going to end up killing each other.
Hey, Starbuck!
You can't possibly believe that Starbuck did this.
Lieutenant Starbuck, to the Galactica brig.
The brig?
It's the law, Starbuck. I'm sorry.
They're gonna convict me. Starbuck and Donald will send Vipers after you. And then what are you gonna do? Fire on Sheba or Boomer or me? If I have to, yes.
So, Murder on the Rising Star. I wonder what this could be about. Adama in his commander's log, which is now a thing, reflects on how the planets they're passing give hints of the presence of the 13th colony, which is a nice bit of progression. Mm-hmm. But it would have been good to have seen some of that for ourselves, maybe. Never mind, because, you know, we're just going to be concentrating on a murder plot for some reason. Then it's more Triad. Yay. Some dude called Ortega does a foul on Starbuck. Well, several fouls on Starbuck. And we get Boomer's opinion from the commentary box. Apparently he's hung up his jock strap and has become a pundit, and who can blame him?
Yeah.
Cassiopeia reflects on how black and blue Starbuck ends up after these matches, and Sheba and Athena have a giggle for obvious reasons. Ty and Adama, meanwhile, are watching the match from a swanky lounge. The officer's mess, maybe? I don't know. Ty is clearly really into Triad. Really, really into Triad. And obviously wants to be watching the match from the ringside. It's possibly the outfits, I'm beginning to suspect, doing it for him, or the smell of manly sweat, I don't know. The match devolves into a fight, and Starbuck claims he'll kill Ortega. Well, that's never going to come back at him, is it?
Mm.
In the corridor, Cassiopeia threatens to put Starbuck and Ortega on report if they throw another punch. Does she outrank them? Interesting thought. Presumably she needs to put them on report.
Yeah, I would think so.
Interesting, isn't it? Medtech outranks pilots. Mm. We'll finish this when your woman is not around, Ortega says. Oh, nice. Murder's too good for him. On his way to meet up with Cassiopeia, Starbuck bumps into a suspicious dude called Chella, who may have just been called, you know, suspicious face.
Really?
Yeah. Meanwhile, Ortega lies dead on the floor. We have another sweet scene with Ty enjoying his night out with Adama. They're a couple. I'm shipping them now. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Actually, I'm not sorry at all. No wonder the commander found Bellaby's advances embarrassing. Clearly, bats for the other side. And he doesn't share Ty's enthusiasm for the game either, and kind of winds him up about it. It's just lovely character moment.
Yeah.
Ortega's body is found, and suspicious face points the finger at Starbuck. Apollo stops Starbuck leaving and finds his laser's been fired. Dr. Wilker does some really implausible tests to do with the way that they can work out how much charge has been used in a zap or whatever. I don't know. And the prosecution lawyer, or chief opposer, as we're calling him apparently, turns up. It's Sire Solon, and he's played by track favourite Brock Peters!
Yay!
A bit of class. Wilker proves Starbuck's weapon did indeed the killing. Yes, it did the killing. It's only weak. It's a wonder I make as much sense as I am, really. A security dude escorts the lieutenant to the brig. He's got a black uniform that looks very cop-like. He just needs the hat to go with it. Apollo says he'll defend his friend, having had some legal training. but never actually done it before.
No.
Oh, thanks, buddy. And he
I've had some legal training. You wouldn't want me defending you, believe me.
No. And he and Boomer do a buddy handshake with their pal.
Oh.
Apollo talks to Ortega's triad partner, Barton, who says that, yeah, Ortega was a bit of a loner. He was also a gambler and apparently thought that only one person had the nerve to kill him, Charybdis. Bam, bam, bam. Who's Charybdis? We don't know at this point.
No.
We get a shot of Barton launching his Viper for no reason other than to fill some space in the plot.
Yes!
Let's face it. Same effect shots as usual.
You kind of feel like they went, we haven't had a Viper launch.
No, we've got to
It's been too long.
It's a sci-fi show. We've got to show the spaceships.
We have to have it happen. Yeah, we pay for this, yeah, this shot.
Yeah, we're going to get our money's worth. Boy, have they got their money's worth. I mean, it looks like it should lead somewhere, that this is part of the plot, but no, just filler. Next, they go back to that computer room we've seen in Gun on Planet Ice Zero. Gun on Ice Planet Zero. And Corporal Commer's still in charge of IT. Bless him. Nice continuity there. Boomer complains that computers keep getting more complicated. He should try Windows 10 someday. And Apollo asks Siri about Charybdis. Because it is, isn't it?
Yeah.
but Siri says no. No match. Computer says no. Solon is talking about the case on Galactica TV, which seems a tad unprofessional considering the
just
trial hasn't happened yet.
And he's sitting there and he's going, you know, oh, you know, well, I suppose he could call on Adama because Adama's, you know, he loves him like a son and we all know that. So clearly he's biased, but I don't think he's going to win. You're like, what?
Yeah, I know, it's dodgy as heck, isn't it? And here's how I'm going to prove he's guilty. Oh, dear. Again, Starbuck is facing life imprisonment, so again, no death penalty. Well done, Galactica, we like you. Cassiopeia tries to get him to change his plea to self-defence, which would mean he wouldn't get life imprisonment, but that understandably undermines his confidence in their relationship bit. What, you don't believe I didn't do it? Oh dear. He's being held in the same dodgy cell as Beltar that has the holes in the door. Let's just not dwell on that, shall we? Starbuck dupes dumb as bricks guards, enabling him to escape. It's just, oh man.
Yeah,
that'll help your case, dude, as well, won't it? He's about to fly out on a Viper. He gets as far as closing the cockpit, which you can clearly see has a big gap between it and the rest of the ship.
I know, it looks awful.
Apparently this was the only working cockpit set they had, so it's beginning to show wear and tear.
Oh, okay, so they only had the one and just over and over and over. Why did they not reuse the shot rather than reuse the prop?
Because they've got different people in it each time.
Oh, okay.
Anyway, it's just as well he doesn't launch into space because he would have died. Apollo talks him out of leaving. Apollo goes to his dad and asks for more time. But apparently colonial law says that these important murder trials have to be rushed to fit into a 45-minute episode. For reasons of dramatic tension, naturally.
Oh,
dear. I can't take your time over this sort of thing. Anyway, Adama reveals he knows who Charybdis is. It's another name for Proteus, Boltar's pilot, and the tech dude who took down the colony's defence computers to allow the Silence to attack. Apparently he's also known as Number 6. Well, that'll make some sense if you haven't seen BSG yet. He was supposed to be killed in the Silent attack, which kind of serves him right, let's face it.
Yeah.
Apollo goes to the only person who knows what Charybdis looks like. Boltar!
Yay! He's wearing a hideous green velour suit.
He is, bless him. And he's loving having a bargaining chip, which he tries to trade for his freedom for the information. Excellent stuff. Aboard in the Rising Star, they spot Chellar, who turns out to be the dealer on Table 3. He confesses to really being called Rifkis. There's an awful lot of alternative names in this one. And we get a flashback complete with wibbly wobbly wibbly wobbly effect, which I've only ever seen in comedies, to be honest. Yeah. So, wow. It's mostly, sadly, just stock footage of the attack on Caprica from Saga of the Star World, though. Hey-ho. He confesses to bribing Ortega into letting him escape on the Rising Star, and this is where it gets a bit dark, in place of a child. Bloody hell.
Yeah.
Turns out Ortega was blackmailing another two escapees with aliases as well. So we've got three suspects at this point. Apollo has worked out that one of them is Charybdis, the one man Ortega said he had the guts to kill him. He tells the three suspects that Boltar knows how to identify Charybdis and tells Boomer he's using this as bait. And sure enough, Charybdis stows away on the shuttle Apollo is using to collect Boltar. We just see the kinky boots at this stage, though.
I know, and they are kinky.
Yes.
Everybody's going for those kinky boots, kinky boots.
Kinky boots, it's a manly kind of fashion that you borrow from the roots.
Borrow from the boots. Kinky boots.
Poor Boomer has to stand in for Apollo at the tribunal. Oh, bless him. And he does his best to do an objection, if a little improperly, as it's pointed
out.
Yeah. Turns out Charybdis can access the shuttle's weapon locker just by pressing a button, which doesn't seem very secure to me, but there you go. Charybdis is revealed, and Apollo gets him to confess he was Ortega's killer, whilst Boomer broadcasts it to the trial. Nice one, Boomer. And Baltar punches his lights out. And the episode ends with a standing ovation for Apollo and Starbuck and the Triad Court. What about poor Boomer?
I don't know.
They would have been screwed without him. He doesn't get any credit whatsoever.
Nope.
He has to stand in to defend the trial, despite the fact that he's clearly, you know, not a defence lawyer.
I know.
They couldn't have cleared Starbuck's name without him, but he gets no credit whatsoever.
Nope.
A Boomer! No. As far as I'm concerned at this point. Oh, and there's a wonderful bit right at the end where they're about to go onto the court and you can see Sheba and Cassiopeia grinning broadly. And that's because the actors have just given Starbuck and Apollo wedgies. So the poor writers were given this pitch late in the day by Glenn A. Larson and had to produce this in 36 hours straight.
Oh, gosh.
So it's a wonder it makes as much sense as it does, to be honest. Yeah, I think it's not a bad little bottle story, and it's fun to have Baltar involved, even if just for a short while, and they're making use of him now being with the fleet. I mean, ultimately, it doesn't work as a murder mystery, because we're not introduced to the murder until right near the end. I mean, that's not fair, is it? You've got no way of working this out. But it's a fun little story, I thought.
Yeah. I remembered it, and the problem is when you remember it and how they work it out, it's sort of...
You didn't remember Baltar being in it, though, did you?
No!
That is, as soon as Baltar turns, it's just like, yes!
Yeah, but it's one of those ones that it does lose something second time round, I think.
Yeah, possibly. I don't know, I gained from it, because I could actually work out what the plot was this time round.
But also, I mean, even if you haven't seen it before, it's bloody obvious Starbuck didn't do it and he's been
He was never going to do it. That was never going to be an issue. But yet again, he throws all his toys out the pram, doesn't he?
Yeah, he does.
His great friend Apollo.
He's like a bloody child.
He is. He's a poor... The more often I see this series, the less and less I like Starbuck, it has to be said.
Yeah.
It was before, it was just the womanising it normally. Now it's the fact that he's just a child.
He is.
Dear, oh dear. Well, anyway, I kind of enjoyed it for all its flaws, but let's see if everybody else absolutely hated it like last time around.
Oh, we've heard from Doreen, who writes, who wants to rechristen Starbuck as Mr. Starbuck O'Brien?
He's not as likable as O'Brien.
After going through the emotional ringer last episode, now he's set up for murder. I guess I'm probably thinking of Deep Space Nine because Grandpa Sisko was in this one, making the episode better with his presence.
Oh, yes.
That's true.
Yeah, he brings a bit of gravitas to it. Yes.
Anthony said there was a wibbly-wobbly flashback, like in Murder, She Wrote.
Yeah, like in... Yes.
Yes. Yes. And I think it had elements from Columbo and Perry Mason.
Yeah, I wouldn't know, but...
It's very Perry Mason to prove that you're the defence and you're proving that person's innocent because you're proving someone else is guilty. That's very Perry Mason.
All right.
In the courtroom.
Thank you, Dory.
Thank you.
We've heard from Jeff. Starbuck is framed for murder, so we get the whodunit courtroom drama in space episode. Thankfully, yes, it's unlike when Next Generation does it. There aren't huge long courtroom scenes, are they? It's mainly just Boomer listening to the the transmission. The biggest highlight this episode was Brock Peters as the chief opposer. Speaking of silly space titles, for the most part, I've liked the goofy alternate terms, as their culture could be totally alien from their own. It does get a bit silly after a while. What did they call a beam in the last episode? So, I don't know what it was, a rigid supporter or something ridiculous like that.
Yes, it was.
Come on, just call it a beam.
Yeah.
I was even willing to accept furlong in lieu of furlough, but turbo washer for showers just too much.
Actually, that made me think of a fucking car wash.
Yeah, that's more likely, isn't it? Stray observations. Colonel Ty really loves triads. Oh, doesn't he? It's fun watching him get caught up in the games. It's a nice extra aspect to his personality beyond stalwart right-hand man to Adama. Now that phrase is taking up new meanings for me. the laser gun ballistics test was cool, even though it made no sense.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. John Colicos was excellent as ever. Yeah. I enjoyed the way he was made part of the resolution. Finally, the governmental system of this fleet makes no sense. Commander Adama is not only Commander-in-Chief of the military, but he also has a seat on the representative deliberative body, and apparently is the Chief of the Judiciary. He's also space pope for them as well, by the way. Putting that much power in one person is frightening. Fortunately, Adama seems to be of exemplary character. Yes. Thanks for that, Jeff.
Thank you.
Okay, on to the MP3s. What did the llama make of this?
There was a muffin in the
Okay then, so this episode gets off to a bad start. Right from the get-go, right just when, as soon as the title's revealed, Murder on the Orient Express, okay, I mean, we know that they've already had a history of ripping off other films and other tropes, but this is going a way bit far. Thankfully, though, this one is slightly more entertaining than the previous drama record, and not just because it opens with scenes of sweaty men wearing very little apart from nappies. Yeah, obviously that sort of fetish is carried on, but yay, someone likes that, that's okay. And Galactica continues its trend of, you know, fetishizing men as well as women, so, you know, I guess that's something for the dads there. As it turns out, though, this story isn't as dull as the previous one. It rattles along fairly nicely, and at the very least it doesn't fall for the trope of the actual murderer being the guy that Starbuck bumps into just before the body's discovered. That's kind of what we're assuming, and we're led to believe all the way through the episode, so it's nice to find out that it's actually someone we actually haven't seen before. So that was an interesting twist on things. And what really carries this episode, as with most of Galactica really, is the performances. There's some lovely moments. I mean, obviously Dirk Benedict plays Starbuck really well. This is the second episode where he's had a lot to do and a lot to prove, so that's really great to see. There's some brilliant moments between Adama and Ty where they're watching the game from afar, and Adama basically keeps just psyching Ty out, and that's brilliant. Especially nice to see that Adama would much rather stay in the bar than be at the courtside where it's loud, noisy access to drinks. That is a man after my own heart, if I actually watch sport, that is. And yeah, so that definitely kept it all the more entertaining. It's also interesting to see that Apollo suddenly decides that he wants to defend Starbuck in court. He's a warrior, not a fighter. It's a ridiculous idea that someone can go from being a warrior to being a lawyer. That's just daft. Hopefully we're not going to see that sort of idea again. And what is really interesting is Cassiopeia and Starbuck's admissions of love for each other. So that's going to be interesting to see where that goes from there on. Are they going to continue seeing other people? Is Starbuck can continue being his slimy cad that he is? Or is there something more interesting going to develop here? So, yeah, I guess we'll wait and see about that one. And the best thing about the episode, of course, is that they get Balto in. Balto is still here. Continuity. He's in prison. And so they get Balto to actually help. Help out of a sense of his own self-preservation. But yeah, it's nice that he's using him. And again, John Colicos obviously relishes the opportunity to be doing anything. And it's just great to see him alongside Apollo in those scenes. And the look of realization when he realizes he's accidentally saved the day, saved Starbuck. That's also great. I did really like that. Of course, the best thing about the episode was Adama's question. Who knows, maybe the 13th tribe will have fallen to become as if like animals. Oh, if only he knew. If only he knew. So, in all, I definitely enjoyed this one a lot more than the previous drama record, but both of these are really in keeping with what more I expected Battlestar Galactic to be more of. So, I'll be interested to see what other people think, especially about you, because obviously I know how much Org actually really loves the courtroom drama thing, so hopefully there was enough non-courtroom stuff here to be able to actually keep him entertained. But I see that there's a two-parter coming up, so we'll see if that continues the trend of the two-parters being better than the standalone episodes. So, I will be back to feedback on that when the time is right, by your command.
Yeah, and the courtroom drama stuff was very limited in this, thankfully.
Yeah.
And I just love Boomer doing his objection thing really badly. That
was
great.
It was bad.
Yeah. What are you talking about? Pointy finger and everything.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm not convinced by Bendy Dick, to be honest. I mean, he's great as face in the A-Team. He's asked a lot more. Is asked of him as Starbuck, and I'm not sure he's got the acting chops to deliver, to be honest. But there we go.
Who else we heard from?
Drew and Tracy.
This is our feedback for Murder on the Rising Star.
So, what did we think of that one?
Yeah, it's all right.
I knew you was going to say that. I knew you was going to go, yeah, it's all right. It's a bit meh.
Well,
what?
I haven't got any more to say than that, to be honest.
This is one of the only few episodes where we haven't talked loads through and written loads of notes.
Certainly didn't write many notes.
Although I did start talking about shopping.
Yes.
I thought this was all right.
Yeah, it wasn't. There was nothing bad about it. It just wasn't really that interesting,
no,
to be honest.
It was a bit predictable.
Mm.
Like, they gave away the fact that Starbuck was going to be kind of arrested and put on trial in the teaser.
Like they always do. Give
so
you
when like
spoilers away, yeah.
There could have been a great big EastEnders moment. Do when like you realise that guy was dead. He was like, yeah, we know.
Yeah.
We know this already. So what are you doing? Why was Starbuck's prosecutor, Joseph Sisko,
yeah,
talking about the case on the telebobs? He was already kind of saying, you know, well, he's already going to be found guilty and this is going to happen and that's going to happen.
Yeah, we've got laws against that, haven't we?
Well, yeah, but it just seemed a bit like he was only assigned the case, like, to centons ago.
Yeah.
And now you're on the telly, Bob, talking to Mrs. Blusher.
Yeah, she's had a lot of makeup on.
Yeah, a lot of makeup. And you don't even know what you're on about.
Yep.
So how is Apollo planning on defending Starbuck when the evidence was right there in front of him, like the gun thingy matched?
Well, you say that. They kept talking about the evidence, didn't they? But yeah. what was the evidence? The fact that Starbuck's gun had been fired and it matched the gun that shot the guy.
And
that isn't evidence.
But that he said that he was going to kill him, basically, and that he was seen running down the hall, and then that guy found his body.
None of them things are evidence that Starbuck killed him.
Well, isn't it circumstantial evidence?
Exactly. Yeah. That none of them are evidence,
but it
are
kind
they?
Of points in the direction that something is,
I'm not saying
it
doesn't,
like,
and it would then be up to the jury if they believe, like, beyond a doubt, but that none of them were evidence. And of course there wasn't evidence, because Starbuck didn't actually kill him.
Exactly.
So,
but then it
didn't, wasn't
see,
evidence.
Then it didn't explain how the gunpowder thingy, but it's not gunpowder, is it? How the lasers matched. So he obviously, like, nicked his gun and then shot the guy.
I guess so, yeah, because I said, it was no doubt it was Starbuck's gun.
So when you had the three on the ship,
yes,
the three guys that I can't remember the
Ortega
one,
was
Ortega.
The one of them, wasn't he?
So the three guys that Ortega was blackmailing, when they got off the ship,
yep,
at Galactica,
yes,
and they were walking off, I did comment on the outfits and I said they've got some real fucking funky outfits going on
they did,
here, yep. And then when you saw the feet or the boots walking back,
Charybdis,
I said to
isn't
you,
it? Yeah.
Ferris Bueller's dad is the killer.
Yeah.
Because I recognised the boots.
I think you could tell
and
it
attacking.
Was in his stature, couldn't you? Yeah.
You knew it wasn't going to be that card dealer.
No.
That was too obvious. The other one looked like Peter Tallcat the monkey, so he was just too, like, sweet. It had to be Ferris Bueller's dad.
Yeah.
And I'd sussed that, and it was just a bit stupid. I mean, Boltar clumped him one right in the noggin, didn't he? So really, they didn't have to shoot him.
I don't know, did he? I
yeah, when Boltar turned around, he pow, right in the face.
Okay,
how he
right,
did that
right,
with
right.
handcuffs, I don't know, but clumped him right in the noggin.
Okay.
Anyway, that was all from me.
Yeah, as I say, it's just, I haven't really got much to say, because I feel like it was just an episode, you know? It was nothing wrong with it. It wasn't any rubbish like unicorns or whatever, or space cowboy hats. But it just also wasn't really nothing to it. It was just a bit,
I didn't quite get, like, the end when they were playing the game, why they all got, like, clappy and...
Oh, it's just like a, you know, 80s,
thing,
70s
yeah.
ending of a programme. We've all got to be smiling and laughing.
Yeah,
you know, it was average.
I didn't mind it. I'm looking at
your
face.
I didn't mind it.
You were just
average.
Meh.
That's as far as I go.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's hope the next one's better.
Yep.
Leave it there.
Okay.
Take it easy. See you later. Bye.
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 Bye. we're sitting there going, playing a game and got clappy. What kind of sex thing is that?
Yeah. But yes, the prosecution is very dodgy talking to TV about the case before it's even gone to trial. That's just not on.
Yeah, very dodgy.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
What did Puri have to say?
Hello again. Puri here to talk about Murder on the Rising Star. This one was actually not bad. You know, it's a plot that you could transfer anywhere, really. So, all of a sudden, Starbuck has a beef with a pilot we've never met before and definitely won't be seeing again, largely because he's a really rough pyramid player. I guess it gives us some antagonism. And in fact, he's so antagonized and he's such a rough pyramid player that apparently it will drive Starbuck to murder. Yes, you know, all the evidence points to Starbuck. We get some, you know, laser ballistics and that sort of thing. And, you know, Starbuck looks like he's going to be accused, and Apollo comes in as his defence. It was nice to see, was it Brock Peters? you know, that's Admiral Cartwright / Joe Sisko, if I'm not very much mistaken. I could see him. He's always a good presence in an episode. And the episode is meant to be kind of Apollo investigating, but because they throw in a kind of Starbuck escape, it really means that half the episode's taken up with Starbuck kind of making a mistake and deciding not to, and then Apollo kind of doing some very quick investigating. And I think if they'd maybe missed out the Starbuck running for it subplot, I think we could have probably got a bit more investigation, which I think would have helped the episode. Because the investigation seemed a bit rushed, you know, he's stuck, and then he finds out that the person could actually be Baltar's pilot. It's actually interesting, that was interesting to find out about the people who'd bribed their way onto ships because they'd missed theirs. And, I mean, I think, again, the only problem was that basically the guy who did it's a guy who we meet in, like, the last 5 minutes of the episode. That's just kind of unsatisfying. Again, if we'd had a bit more space for this one to unfold, and you could have got the guy who, you know, the sort of idea that people were, you know, people are under false identities because they bribed their way onto ships that they shouldn't have been on in place of more needy people, and that we could have actually had our suspect list from that, and this guy was blackmailing all of them because he was the one who took the bribes to begin with. I think that could have actually worked out a lot better than this. As I say, it just seemed a bit unsatisfying at the end, but it kept my attention. We had some more future sport, which is always fun, so yeah, it wasn't awful. I wouldn't call it great. It's, you know, again, if I'm breaking out the Battlestar Galactica box and I'm going to watch an episode, I'm not going to say let's watch Murder on the Rising Star. I'm going to say, you know, I'll watch something better. Just another episode. But, yeah, I'll watch Fire in Space again. I like that. But still, this one definitely passed the time and definitely kept my attention more than the last one. So, yeah, this one wasn't too bad. It wasn't great, but it was passable. It was workmanlike and functional. And particularly for these individual episodes, we can't ask more than that. So all that remains for me to say is do keep up the good work. I always look forward to the podcast, and I hope to feedback in the next one. Until then, bye for now.
Bye.
Bye, Barry. Thank you.
It does have a lot to keep your attention.
Yeah. And it does have its... I think he perfectly highlighted its limitations. Poor Apollo's case is rushed because of the arbitrary time limit on, you know, the amount of time he gets to prepare to defend the murder victim. Blimey. And he had Starbuck running for it is just stupid. It just underlines how stupid he is as a character, unfortunately.
Yeah.
And introducing the murderer in the last 5 minutes, definitely unsatisfying. Yeah. I mean, it's not up there with Fire in Space as a single episode, but... it's okay. It's daft fun, as far as I'm concerned. Rather like the last one, really. But, yeah, no point boring or just daft.
Yeah. Yeah, I enjoyed the previous one more than this one.
Mm-hmm. I think that was the other way around, but...
Oh, okay. I liked the Fred Astaire one. This was all right.
It was, yeah. It's fun enough. Righty. Well, yeah, next time we cover a bit of a curiosity, because it's not a two-parter, but it's a double-length episode.
Oh, okay.
So I guess that will mean we'll have to sort of stop halfway through and I'll take over from you, I guess. But, yes, Greetings from Earth, which I do remember from our last rewatch of this. I don't remember it being good, I'm afraid, just to...
Oh.
Yes, prepare you. It's... Okay, it involves two of the dodgiest robots ever... to have been put on screen.
Okay.
Yes. Anyway, we'll be recording that on the 3rd of May. Feel free to give us your thoughts on the double episode that is Greetings from Earth. Cheery by your leave.
Okay, yes, cheery by your leave.
Everybody's going for the kinky boots, kinky boots.
Kinky boots, it's a manly kind of fashion that you borrow from the roots.
Borrow from the boots.
The music at the beginning of this podcast was arranged and performed by Drew Barker.
All other music is used for illustrative purposes only, and no copyright infringement is intended.
The artwork for Borgcast Galactica was created by Lee Metcalf.
To contact us, send emails or MP3s to borgcast@gmail.com.
Contact us via Twitter at rev_org or borgcastammo, hashtag borgcast.
Visit our website at galactica.libsyn.com.
Or view images relating to our cast on our Tumblr site, borgcast.tumblr.com.
And there's also a Spotify playlist with all our playout tunes on it.
Puss in Boots, footwear manufacturers are gathering the fruits.
Gathering the fruits. Kinky Boots, advertising men say try 'em.
And you all run amok like a flock of sheep to buy 'em.
Sweet girls, sweet girls.
Frumpy little beach girls.
Square girls, cool girls.
Sexy little school girls.
Need 'em.
Shut it down!
By your command.